Hello and welcome everyone to Financing Philadelphia's Future with Councilmember Derek Green. We do this monthly and it's usually a live Q&A about creating a Philadelphia public bank. Today it's a little special because to accommodate schedules, we're pre-taping this, but we're going to have some great questions. It's going to be a great conversation. Thank you for joining us. I'm your moderator. I'm Vanessa Lowe. I co-chair the Economic Dignity Team for Power, Philadelphians organized to witness, empower, and rebuild. I also host a show called Vanessa's Money Hour on G-Town Radio in Northwest Philadelphia. So like I said, today's gonna be a little different. We have the usual 30 minutes, so let's go ahead and get started. Let me introduce our regular speaker. Councilmember Derek Green is serving his second term as City Councilmember at large. He has a background in banking and a deep commitment to sustainable economic development, particularly for Philly's Black and Brown neighborhoods. He chairs the committees on finance and disabilities. His top legislative priority is the establishment of a Philadelphia public bank. Welcome. Our guest today is Shimon Walton, who was elected to the San Francisco Board of Supervisors in 2019 and was elected president of that body in January 2021. For those of us who are in Philadelphia, we think of that as our city council, the board. They call it the Board of Supervisors in San Francisco. All right, I am going to turn it over to Councilmember Green to open us up with a little update. Councilmember Green.
Well, thank you, Vanessa. It's always a pleasure to be with all of you and having this conversation regarding the growth of public banking in the city of Philadelphia. We're making real progress. I'm looking forward to the Visioning Summit, which is coming up shortly on Saturday, September 18th. In addition, our first session of council is September 16th, and we're looking forward to putting together some legal work from Holland & Knight, who is the law firm that's been working with us on helping us to create the public bank. And we look forward to having a legal memo from them that will help guide us in reference to amendments that we'll make to the legislation that was introduced. So that way we could have hearings this fall and then move forward with the public bank and hopefully have the legislation passed and then also work on financing and getting funding for the public bank in next year's budget cycle. So I'm looking forward to this conversation with my friend, President Shimon Walton of the Board of Supervisors of San Francisco, and hearing about the great work that they are doing on the West Coast to bring a public bank to that great city.
Great. And maybe some opening words from Shimon Walton. We welcome you.
Thank you so much for having me. And Councilman Green, it's always a pleasure and great to see you. I just briefly want to say that obviously the public banking conversation has been happening for decades, and my former colleague, Supervisor Feuer, we were serving on the Board of Education together. She would always talk about the idea of public banking. She got elected to the Board of Supervisors prior to my arrival, began to champion the work. Upon getting elected to the Board of Supervisors, I reached out to our State Assembly member, David Chu. He pushed it through the state legislature to allow authorization for public bank charters and local municipalities here in the state. And now Supervisor Dean Preston, another one of my colleagues, has picked up the torch and is working and taking the lead on public bank here in San Francisco. But this is something that is important and vital to our residents so that we can make sure that everyone has an opportunity to invest, have an opportunity to own homes, and have an opportunity not to be subject to predatory lending here in the city and county of San Francisco.
How wonderful to have two city leaders working in different cities on such an amazing and timely issue. So wonderful. I'm gonna ask Peter Winslow. It sounds like he's moderating our questions. Peter, are there any questions yet?
We have a few. From Stan Shapiro's question of, how do you combat the cynical view that you just can't trust politicians with money, and therefore a public bank will inevitably make politically influenced loans?
Well, I'll jump in. And the first thing is, the good thing about a public bank, again, it is going to be publicly ran and operated. Here, we had a 16-member feasibility task force put in place first to talk about, have a conversation about the possibilities of having a public bank, what it would look like. And then we just had a June 3rd at our Government and Audit and Oversight Committee, we passed this 9-member committee that now will look into the models that we want for a public bank, how they will operate and how that will work. Us as elected officials wouldn't necessarily be in control of the bank, first of all, and we have a treasurer, and we also have other means and ways to make sure that we put something in place to where it's out of the hands of local politicians, which I think is the best policy in the first place. But with a $13 billion plus dollar budget, surely we can make sure that we put a public bank in effect that's going to benefit the residents here in San Francisco. And there is no way, shape, form, or fashion why we as the elected officials should be operating the bank in the first place.
And Vanessa, if I could follow up on that point, there's some of the points that President Walden talked about are also some of the challenges we're seeing here in Philadelphia. I'm making sure that this public bank is an independent entity. In addition, because we're looking to have Philadelphia's public bank as a community development financial institution, there's certain steps that we would have to take that would ensure its independence from public officials and some of the questions that people raised, including the question that Peter just raised. But when President Walden talked about the interest in starting a public bank and talking about predatory lending, reminded me of my own background and perspective and how I got involved in predatory lending. So I'm curious, in this perspective, what's the public saying about this whole idea of the public bank, and how are you educating them about this type of initiative and how it can help people in your city?
Well, here in San Francisco, folks are very excited about the opportunity for a public bank. In fact, you know, we had a groundswell of folks working together. We have a public bank coalition that is really working statewide to make this happen. So the excitement has been amazing, and we wouldn't have been able to champion this at the state level without all of the public support, because Assemblymember Chu had a lot of roadblocks when he was pushing this through the legislature. A lot of folks, and a lot, particularly our private banks, tried to fight this. They tried to lobby other state members of the state legislature so that this would not happen. And it was a battle, and it wasn't as easy as we thought. And I was shocked because banks are making enormous profits during the pandemic, and they have been, you know, for the past 100 years plus. And so for them to fight this tells me that how important it is for our people. If the banks are going to put that much money into combating a public bank, that means that this is something that is important and vital for our folks to not be able to continue to be taken advantage of. And we have so many folks that have come out and fought and pushed us, quite frankly, here on the Board of Supervisors, and also pushed at the state level. So many rallies, so many different events, and showing up at the state legislature to speak on behalf of being able to authorize the charter for public banks. So we have a groundswell of public support, which is the reason why it's very exciting, because the people are speaking and pushing for this to be a reality.
I like what you said. I mean, it's interesting that the phrasing that you use is sort of they're pushing back so much, so it's a sign that it's really needed, because it's essentially saying they profit quite a bit off of taking the city money, right? So yeah, we should be using those profits instead for the citizens of our cities. Absolutely. Going back to you, Peter, give us another question.
We have a question from Pamela Haynes asking to follow up on what you've just said, President Walden. Do you have any insights about how to respond effectively to the opposition that you're receiving and we're anticipating from private banks? The way we are viewing this is that our public bank is going to support the entire financial local ecosystem, which should be beneficial and helpful to local banks. So what's their problem?
Well, one, banks are always in competition, right? I mean, private banks are in competition with other private banks. They're in competition with credit unions. But the reality of it is, the more opportunities, the more choices that people have, the better the services are going to be for our residents. You know, and I know, when there's competition, people show up better, and they perform better, and they do a better job of taking care of the people that they serve. And so if us starting a public bank is also going to make our private banks be more responsible, I think that's beneficial for the people, which of course is the main goal and the main focus. But it also gives our private institutions an opportunity to step up and become better institutions. We are very aware of some of the scandals and some of the some of the things that our private banks have done to members and community and continue to do. And this is going to be a valuable way for us to counter that. And it's going to make them do better and give them an opportunity to show up better for the public, which I think is important. And, you know, creating that competition and letting municipalities be able to provide opportunities for our residents and the people who live in our cities is beneficial for everyone. And that's the main focus, is to benefit the masses, do a good job of allowing opportunity for growth and investment and financial security for everyone.
Peter, I'm going to come back to you because I think I saw some follow-up questions there, but I have it's a bit of a follow-up, but it's also just something I saw in your profile that you were very much involved with the Board of Education, I think head of the Board of Education out there for a while. Can you speak to maybe how the existence of a public bank would affect the school system and the education system in your area?
Well, I think here, if you look at the fact that we have kindergarten and college fund already in place where people can invest in the future of their children. And we already provide a match and support here in the city and county of San Francisco for members who are going to our public schools. And just imagine being able to use a portion of our $13+ billion budget to increase that investment, increase that match for our young people and our students, that puts them on the path to pathway to college or a pathway to whatever they want to do in terms of higher education or when they leave high school. That's a big part of this. And the fact that we already do it, putting a public bank in place will allow us to build off of that and increase the investment and increase the opportunity. So this, you know, benefits our public school students and benefits families in ways that we haven't been able to see before. Because again, we would have the opportunity to either do no interest, low interest when it comes to loans. We would be able to match investments and just provide an opportunity that hasn't been seen before.
Vanessa, if I could follow briefly on that, one of the benefits of having a public bank, in addition to the ideas they're doing in San Francisco, is also financial literacy. Many of us remember, I know I remember getting a passbook savings account in the back in the day. For those of you in the Philadelphia area watching this, PSFS, or the Philadelphia Savings Fund Society, which you got a little scotch card, or I forget the actual look of your passbook savings account, where you got money, and there was a much more financial literacy perspective, you know, back in the day. And now banks don't do that same type of information and education for young people, as well as those in our public sector work in city employment. So imagine the ability of a public bank that can also help promote financial literacy and work with some of the other nonprofits in Philadelphia, in the region, that do some of that work and help get their message out of how we can be better stewards of our money, which helps our entire ecosystem in Philadelphia. And I'm sure it's doing the same thing in San Francisco.
Yeah, and those things happen when we have a relationship with those banks. So I think reestablishing that could really help. I'm going to go back to you, Peter. Questions?
Yes. So in terms of the pathway forward, you know, the public bank in each of your cities has to start somewhere and then go from there to the next step, the next step. In San Francisco, there's an emphasis on affordable housing. In Philadelphia, there's an emphasis on supporting minority small business. These are not exclusive. To what extent do you think the programs of the banks can encompass all the needs that the bank can address?
Well, I would just say, you know, we now have approved a 9-member task force to look at the different models and opportunities of what a public bank could be and look like. Our budget and legislative analysts who really advise the Board of Supervisors in terms of what to do with our city resources, they recommended establishing a non-depository MFC first, and this provides advantages of lower operating costs, no FDIC approval needed to operate, originates loans at lower rates to achieve profitability immediately, capitalized by investment pool and interest earnings. And we can start there and do a phased in approach to become a more complete bank that does everything. But the reality of it is, we need to start somewhere. build the bank that has the public trust and provides opportunity for the public. And then the sky can be the limit in terms of what the public bank can do. But obviously, being a newer concept and only having one in the country that I'm aware of, we have a lot of opportunity for growth to go in the right direction and become a full service bank at some point.
Yeah, and just to follow up on that question, Vanessa, if I can just follow up on that point real quick. I think that approach is very similar. President Walton was talking about the steps they're taking. It reminds you a lot of the conversation we're having here in Philadelphia, how we started our first phase and then grow, especially trying to provide access to credit and assistance to those hard to lend to entities like affordable housing developers. We talked about minority businesses, also cooperatives and others who are doing alternative energy. So I think it's that phased in approach, which helps to put the naysayers to the side and helps us to have success going forward.
Great, and I apologize for interrupting. I just wanted to clarify what MFC said. You said non-depository MFC. What is MFC for our audience? Clarification.
I knew you were gonna ask me that question. I was looking at my notes, I'm gonna get that. I am not a banker, but take notes. I'm going to get you that that answer in a minute.
Cool beans. We'll go on to a next question. I'm somebody, when I hear an acronym, I just sort of shut down when I don't know what that acronym is.
Most definitely.
All right. Let me go back to Peter. Any other questions, Peter?
Yeah, I think we're talking about a revolving fund as opposed to a bank that can engage in fractional fractional lending. So I guess that leads to the next question of how soon do you think this is going to actually happen? Both of you men are leading the nation in terms of municipal public banking, but there are a lot of other places in California and New York and around the country that are doing the same. How soon do you think this can get started?
Well, I'll jump in first. I know President Walt was looking for that acronym for Vanessa. I think one of the benefits we have here in Philadelphia that there's some other entities that are creating things that are similar to the public bank concept here in Philadelphia. We have the Philadelphia Green Capital Corporation, and we had Mary Rose Martellis, who is the head of that initiative, which came out of the Philadelphia Energy Authority. Also Greg Heller with the Accelerator Fund. And both of those organizations, one, the Accelerator Fund is up and running. The Philadelphia Green Capital Corporation will be launching in a few weeks. Both of those entities are providing vital information and a roadmap for what we're trying to do with a public bank. So I'm looking forward to amendments to the legislation occurring this fall and having the entity getting created, and then finding resources to fund our public bank in Philadelphia as we go through the budget process. So as we go into 2022 and we get to hopefully by this time next year, we'll be on our way in a major way to having this created.
And MFC is an amazing name for a bank for a city. It's actually Municipal Financial Corporation. I knew I had that somewhere in my notes.
There you go.
But thank you so much, because it's important.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Definitely. It's important we spell out those acronyms.
Thank you. Our task force
is going to get to work.
Absolutely.
Immediately. And hopefully we can have something in place within the year in terms of the direction we want to go in for a public bank, how we're going to finance it as a city, and really get the work started. Again, we're blessed by the fact that the state authorized us the opportunity to now be able to come up with the municipal bank. So now it's time for the task force to go to work, come with the ideas and the strategies so that us as the Board of Supervisors can make this a reality here, along with the executive branch in San Francisco.
Great. Peter, I'm ready for another question, but I also want to make sure that we're leaving time to maybe give some highlights of the upcoming summit, just to kind of do a little commercial before we run out of time. So I'll leave it to you to decide when we want to do that, okay? But let's get another question right now.
Well, let's circle back to where you started the discussion. And give us some advice as to what we as citizens can do to be helpful to support the efforts that you're leading? You're our champions. What can we do to help?
Well, I would just say that, you know, we need obviously our residents, our constituents to come forward and tell real stories about how they've been taken advantage of, the things that have happened to them by private banks, so that we can tell their story and really get people to recognize the importance of a public bank, the importance of the people being able to provide financial opportunities for each other and, you know, show up to rallies, show up to any time there's going to be events that address public banking, make sure that whenever it happens at the local level or at the state level, when we're pushing legislation through or things that are happening that are going to benefit the path forward for public banking, that people show up. Write your local state representative, write your local city council member, write your local member of the Board of Supervisors. You know, do everything that you can to make it known the importance of us changing the way that banking happens, and it can be beneficial for even members of the low-income community. We don't have to have banks that are in place and only allow people who are upper middle class and rich to benefit from those banking opportunities. And this is what a public bank will do. And we need people to be able to tell the story so that we can be successful in continuing this push for the public bank.
And I would say to follow up on the comments from President Walton, just really want to thank the Philadelphia Public Bank Coalition for raising this issue initially, not only here in Philadelphia. There have been a number of op-eds. I think this is what led to the editorial from the Philadelphia Inquirer supporting the concept of a public bank. And that's through the hard work of this coalition and this committee of bringing other organizations together, getting their buy-in, letting them know what this whole idea of a public bank is, reaching out to other groups around the nation who've been doing work in this regard, like the great work that President Walton is doing in San Francisco and other advocates. And so just even having this conversation on a regular basis helps to educate people about what a public bank is and what it's not. I know from my interaction with those who are bankers, those from the community development financial institution world, from just constituents who have come up to me or sent me a message to have heard about the public bank, either through this program that we've been doing on a regular basis, from op-eds, or emails, other conversations. And so I think the work that this coalition and this committee is doing has really helped to lead this conversation in Philadelphia, and it's also something that I think other jurisdictions around the country are also seeing, and it'll be a model for them to be able to bring the same conversation to their city.
Yeah, really good point. Community activism is what often starts these things, and we take it to legislators who we think will support it, and they bring it on home in collaboration with those activists. Peter, do you have another question?
Well, going into the different models that you've been looking at and that have been looked at in both jurisdictions, is there a model that that makes the most sense to you, or what are the criteria that you use to assess the models? Because there's so many different needs that a public bank can address.
Well, from a criteria standpoint, I don't want to get ahead of the 9-member body that we have in place, who's really going to be looking at what opportunities exist for a public bank, which models may work well. But I will say, like I said earlier, we may be looking at something that's non-depository, but does, you know, provide opportunities for loans at low interest, provides opportunities for possibility of check cashing and stopping the predatory check cashing that exists in our communities. But we're really going to look at what suggestions come from the working group and the task force and build off of that and go in that direction. But, you know, there's so many opportunities available and ways to decide what you want to do with your public bank first. But the main thing, and ultimately where I want to end up, is making sure that there are opportunities for investment for individuals who haven't typically had that, making sure there are opportunities for folks to purchase homes and purchase property that wouldn't typically have an opportunity, where a private bank wouldn't give them that opportunity to be able to do that. And using city resources and working with constituents, be able to create something that is innovative and never before done, particularly for the low-income community.
And I think from a Philadelphia perspective, very similar. We're looking at how do we find a way to provide access to services that traditionally many communities have not been able to have access to, either businesses in low to moderate income or from businesses of color to affordable housing developers, new energy opportunities like solar, as well as cooperatives, and all of these type of areas that traditionally banks have made it very difficult for them to lend to. And I can talk from my own personal experience being a former banker here in Philadelphia. And so these are some of the things that we're trying to do with our initiative.
Great. Peter? I saw a question from Tim Brown.
Tim has a question as to what were the biggest obstacles or continue to be your biggest obstacles in San Francisco to the establishment of a public bank? And also, what are the obstacles in Philadelphia?
Well, for San Francisco, I think the biggest obstacles we had really were at the state fight, when we had private bank institutions trying to lobby the state legislature and do everything they could to prevent us from getting authorization to create public banks here locally. And we had a groundswell of public support, public bank coalition, and many constituents just really fight hard to make sure that it got to the legislature. So that was our biggest obstacle. Now it's really gonna be, of course, how do you finance the public bank and where do you get those resources from? You can't use all of SF resources to do it. So it's not just easy as saying, let's carve out this amount of money to start a public bank. And so that is something that we're gonna have to be strategic about, and something that is important as we move forward. I can see that as being an obstacle, but we do have the support of the people. We do have the support of our treasurer. And so the work is, you know, we're excited about the work ahead.
All right, great. We have about 2 minutes. Can you speak to that, Councilmember Green?
Yeah, and I was gonna say very quickly, Philadelphia has a lot of the same obstacles that President Walton talked about almost verbatim. And so that's why I think it's important that we're having this conversation, and also the upcoming Public Bank Visioning Summit, which is gonna be on Saturday, September 18th. And so I'm not sure if Vanessa or Peter, if you would like to talk about that as we close out.
Peter, please give us some highlights. What time? Remind folks, it is all virtual. So, and maybe names and guest names.
Yeah, so we're gonna be using Zoom, that people are familiar with. The summit is going to be held on Saturday, September 18th, from 1 o'clock to 4 o'clock Eastern time. And we're looking for participation from folks in Philadelphia, but also from people around the country, since in California and New York and Chicago and Seattle and San Francisco, lots of places are looking to establish municipal public banks. So we have a very full roster. We're very pleased that President Shaman Walton is going to be one of our participants. There are several people from the Public Banking Institute and lots of perspectives and people working together to form a vision for what the public bank can be and should be.
Great. And I know one of the components, or a couple of speakers, are going to definitely speak to sort of racial justice issues and how a public bank is really going to help move us more towards racial justice. So that would be great. I think we need to close it out right now. In September, let me move that. September 28th, our next event, it will be Greg Heller, Senior Vice President of the Philadelphia Housing Development Corporation. He will be our guest on the next Financing Philadelphia's Future. We'll see you then. Councilmember Green, want to say a quick goodbye?
I just want to thank Vanessa for being the great moderator that you are, the Oprah Winfrey of our public bank conversation, and just want to thank President Walton for spending some time with us and giving some insight on the great work they're doing in San Francisco.
See you next month, folks.